गुड मॉर्निंग क्लास, आर यू एबल टू हियर मी? लेट मी नो इफ द ऑडियो इज फाइन एंड यू एबल टू हियर मी विदाउट एनी ब्रेक्स। और देर इज एनी फ्लक्चुएशन इन द ऑडिबिलिटी। ओके, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडेज़ क्लास इज अबाउट इंटरस्टीशियल लंग डिजीज। It is one of the most perplexing topic in your medical school, if not the most. And so you have to bear with me for a moment and take it easy. Don't worry about this is a very complex and a little confusing topic. Interstitial lung disease. So we'll start with the class without losing any more time. So what is interstitial lung disease? The interstitium means, as you can see visibly, you can see radiographically, it's a space of loose connective tissue throughout the lung and composed of three subdivisions. First one is bronchovascular all the bronchovascular pedicle surrounding the bronchi. So it starts from here, the arteries, this pulmonary artery, then veins, from the lung roots to the level of respiratory bronchioles. So this is the parenchyma. Then the second thing is the parenchyma. Parenchyma is the whole sinus. The whole sinus, where it is situated between alveoli and the capillary basement membrane. And this is the lymphatics. And these are the subpleura, which is, this is all subpleura. So it's beneath the pleura, as well as interlobular spaces, which can't be seen on this, can't be properly seen on this one. So this is all the about interstitium. So ILD is basically, it represents a whole plethora of conditions which involve the parenchyma of the lung. And parenchyma constitutes the alveoli, the alveolar epithelium. As you can see, this is the alveoli, alveolar epithelium. Then capillary endothelium and the spaces between these structures, as well as perivascular and the lymphatic tissues. This is the whole things gets involved in the ILDs. So epidemiologically, ILDs, it was not considered to be very common in India in the past period. But with the recent technological advancement, we have started detecting more ILDs in the due course. And it now constitutes about 10-15% of the patient with respiratory diseases, and in most of them are idiopathic, almost 50%, and especially those associated with connective tissue disorders. And overall, the most common is this usual interstitial pneumonitis, also known as interstitial pulmonary fibrosis, which is the very most common form of ILD, and it doesn't have a good prognosis. So this is the basically as close as we can get in simplifying the classification of the ILDs. So basically what we have to follow a particular pattern in order to understand the ILDs. So always remember as we go back to your pathology class, the ILDs, the mode of mode of mechanism is basically, it's either through granulomatous reaction or through inflammation of the alveoli, causing alveolitis. So it is basically either the ILD will be of known association, like those associated with connective tissue disorders, and drugs like nitrofurantoin or amiodarone. There are a lot plethora of drugs. We'll take up these separate topics in the next class. Then occupational exposures are like organic and mostly inorganic exposures. So those are people working in the cement factories, then in the mines, working in the mines, it's coal mines, or people's silicosis, berylliosis, people working in the car factories, then asbestosis. Then granulomatous is like very typical is the sarcoidosis, and you have something called hypersensitive pneumonitis. And others are those vasculitis like Wegener's granulomatosis or Church-Strauss syndrome. So these all cause granulomatous ILDs. Then this is the whole class, idiopathic interstitial pneumonia. This is a whole class of unknown cause of ILDs. And major were, I talked about idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, is very common. Non-specific interstitial pneumonia. These terms have to be remembered the way they are being represented over here. Then you have cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. Then you have something called respiratory bronchiolitis, ILDs, desquamative interstitial pneumonia, and acute interstitial pneumonia. These are more related to smoking, so more predisposed through smoking. Then rare ILDs, you can just go through the names. Then you have the miscellaneous ILDs, lymphangio, leiomyomatosis, which is very common in premenopausal women. Then pulmonary Langerhans cysticercitosis. So this is also have predisposition with smoking. This is another one way of classifying the ILDs. So basically, what I'll try to put the ILDs under two categories. The first one is inflammation, alveolitis, and fibrosis. As inflammation ensues and it causes alveolitis, and then the body tries to heal itself. As the process inflammation continues, and with the recurrent inflammation, the lungs might go for fibrotic changes and scarring. So the other one is, the second one is the granulomatosis. So these are the both mode of mechanism of the insult which happens in the ILDs. So inflammation, alveolitis, and fibrosis, one category, and there you will have unknown causes. And the other one is unknown causes. So the known causes will be like fumes and gases. We talked about those people working in the mines or the coal mines, or people working in the factories. So silicosis, berylliosis, or drugs like antibiotics, then amiodarone, gold, and chemotherapy. Certain chemotherapy drugs. Then you have methotrexate, and these all are also responsible. Then asbestosis, we talked about asbestosis. Very peculiar about this asbestosis is it is one of the occupational disease of the or the cause of the ILDs. But there you have another, you have more, wherever you have silicosis and berylliosis, but they are causing, actually a granulomatous insult and rather than the alveolitis and fibrotic insult. So asbestosis, that's how it is one of the cause for alveolitis or fibrotic pattern of ILDs. Then radiation induced ILDs, then aspiration pneumonia leading to ILDs, then something residual of acute respiratory distress syndrome. Smoking related, I talked about desquamative interstitial pneumonia, respiratory bronchiolitis associated interstitial lung disease, then pulmonary Langerhans cell granulomatosis. Then the unknown causes, idiopathic interstitial pneumonia. And then among them you have idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, Then you have acute interstitial pneumonia, which is diffuse alveolar damage. Then cryptogenic organizing pneumonia and non-specific interstitial pneumonia. Then idiopathic lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia. And these names are, I understand you're finding it a little bothersome, but we'll classify each and every one of it in the next class. We'll get a short classification, and that will enough for at your level. So then there's something called pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, where there is increased production of surfactant. Then you have lymphocytic infiltrative disorders, which may be associated with connective tissue diseases. Then you have eosinophilic pneumonias, lymphangioleiomyomatosis is very important, and sanitary inherited disorders like Hermansky-Pudlak syndrome, tuberous sclerosis. Then the association with the connective tissue disorders, you have SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, and systemic sclerosis, which is again very common, Sjögren syndrome, polymyositis, and dermatitis. These all are the connective tissue disorder. The association of ILDs with the connective tissue disorders, with the unknown causes. Then the miscellaneous ones are pulmonary hemorrhage syndrome, the whole thing consists of good pasture syndrome, idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis, then amyloidosis, then certain GIT or liver diseases like Crohn's disease, primary biliary cirrhosis, ulcerative colitis, and then most importantly graft versus host disease in a bone marrow transplant. And then the other is the granulomatous pattern, where you have again a known cause and an unknown cause. As I showed in this inflammatory alveolitis pattern, you have a known cause and the unknown cause. So similarly, you have a granulomatous pattern where you have a known cause and you have an unknown cause. In known cause, you have hypersensitive pneumonitis, where the organic dust, I talked about berylosis and silicosis, these even the beryllium, inorganic dust. The organic dust are basically our farmer's lungs, actinomyces, for those bird breeders, then the animal handlers, and those actinomyces inhalation, those fungal molds. These are the organic dust. The inorganic dust we talked about is beryllium and silica. When we talked about asbestosis, remember the asbestosis causes inflammatory and alveolitis kind of pattern of ILDs, while these cause beryllium and silica causes granulomatous pattern of ILDs. Then unknown causes, one of them very common is the sarcoidosis, very important one. Then granulomatous vasculitis like Wegener's, granulomatosis with polyangiitis, it is called, as you have must have learned in your pathology semester. Then eosinophilic granulomatosis, polyangiitis, that's Judge-Strauss syndrome, and certain other bronchocentric and lymphomatoid granulomatosis. The pathogenesis is basically through the any insult with the predisposing factors, certain genetic setups and environmental fumes or pollutants, or smoking being one of them, very important and major reason, major factor. Then the other thing is autoimmune condition, and can be then radiation induced or transplant patients, post-transplant rejection, or in cases of drugs. So what they basically cause, they cause an insult and they cause an microscopic lung injuries, and as the it is mediated through the T cells and macrophages and through several mechanisms. So the result is basically either the body try to combat the insult and then leading to wound healing and all, or if the insult is recurrent and chronic insult, or sometimes even acute hypersensitive mediated insult, and that can lead to either homeostasis or pulmonary fibrosis. And there's a pulmonary fibrosis, there will be like loss of the compliance and then the reduction in the lung volumes and destruction of the alveoli with the because of the alveolitis. And then there will be discrepancy in the gas exchange, and then there will be arterioalveolar gas ratio will enhance, and that can lead to again pulmonary vasculature changes and pulmonary hypertension, which invariably leads to right heart failure. So there's a several, the whole several mechanism is, it goes through the whole process, and it can be divided into acute, subacute and chronic manifestation. And mostly the ILDs, we'll talk about the chronicity in the subsequent slides. The hallmark of ILDs, always remember, all ILDs, it is progressive dyspnea, and it has a restrictive physiology on PFT. The important word is restrictive physiology on PFT. So it will denote decrease in FEV1 and decrease in FVC. But the whole ratio, the ratio of FEV1 and FVC will be either be normal or may be raised. So that is the one typical finding of PFT in ILDs. Then on chest X-ray, this is a very regular bilateral diffuse reticular infiltrates or ground glass opacity, which is more appreciated on CT or high resolution CT scan of the thorax. Then the clinical features, as will be dyspnea on exertion. The dyspnea usually be present on exertion. The patient might complain that he has started having a breathlessness on walking a flight of stairs, and which wasn't there. The onset may be acute, it can be subacute, and mostly the onset of dyspnea is subacute or chronic. Whenever it is an acute, you should consider some other etiologies. The non-productive cough. The cough is then, since it is a non-infective entity, so the cough will usually be non-productive. And the other constitutive symptoms, which is bread and butter of this entity, is low-grade fever and malaise. As happens in the connective tissue disorders, then fatigue and weight loss. As happens in any chronic diseases. On physical examination, very important finding is bibacillar inspiratory crackles. And important about this is this bibacillary inspiratory crackles is a very significant finding, because usually in cases of ILDs, you will have the crepitations will be inspiratory. But how you can differentiate with the COPDs and asthmas. In COPDs, as you remember, the crepitation may be present in the inspiration as well as expiration, and in asthma it is absolutely end expiratory. But in cases of ILDs, usually it is the inspiratory crackers which throws the doubts on the diagnosis whenever you have an inspiratory crepitations. Then clubbing, and the clubbing is an indication of a very advanced fibrotic lung disease, and it's usually present as a patient presents to you, because it's usually most of the ILDs have an indolent course, a slow progressive course. So most of the patient will have clubbing by the time they present to you. But usually not seen in drug-induced ILDs. And again, I said, if there is any new onset of clubbing, you might think about concomitant development of lung cancer. And sinuses will be there if there is a severe hypoxemia, or it is accompanied by pulmonary hypertension and right heart failure. So that can lead to sinuses. Medical history, as the name suggests, the most important thing is we should take a proper medical history of focusing on the patient's occupational profile and the environmental exposure, which is very important. and evaluation of all the medical patients' current medications, and progression of the respiratory symptom is another one important thing to look up to. Then the other thing is, as I talked about the chronicity, mostly the acute onset will be either alveolar hemorrhage syndrome or hypersensitive pneumonitis, that is through the inhalation of the organic actinomyces, organic molds, that leads to hypersensitive acute reaction, and that could also present as an acute presentation. Then the chronic is a very subacute. Again, subacute is something like sarcoidosis or other connective tissue disorders. They can present from subchronic to subacute to chronic onset, and something like idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is pulmonary fibrosis have a very slow progressive and indolent course, and definitely the presentation will be a chronic one. Lab test, we should order normal WBC count will be normal, or if it is a drug induced, in collaboration with the connective tissue disease, there might be certain alteration in the WBC counts, but otherwise you will usually on blood examination you might find a peripheral blood eosinophilia, or on a serological blood testing you can do for specific connective tissue disorders like anti-neutrophilin antibodies or double stranded DNA antibodies, or anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibody ANCA for Regner's and microscopic polyngitis, or anti-glomerular basement membrane antibody for Goodpasture syndrome. And then we talked about the pulmonary function test, and the classical finding on the PFT is a reduction in FEV1 and FVC with a normal or elevated FEV1 by FVC ratio. And then the total lung capacity will usually be low, and the deficient capacity for carbon dioxide for the lungs will definitely be decreased. But that is a non-specific finding, because that can present in so many other diseases. Then chest wall and neuromuscular disorders may have a normal DLC if that is the cause for the IEDs, and they will have a reduced total lung capacity. Arterial blood gas analysis will again be, as you will see, reduction in the saturation or partial arterial pressure of the oxygen. In patients who have a normal gas exchange at rest, you can do something like cardiopulmonary exercise test or 6-minute walk test, because of the submaximal exercise capacity of the patient. Now the radiological study is very typical. Any patient coming to you with ILD, is this certain aspects of ILD is in certain diseases of the or the causes of ILDs, the patient will come to you with a subtle chest X-ray finding, with a subtle CT scan finding, but symptom wise the patient will be, the symptom might not correspond to the with the disease progression radiologically. That might happen too often, because it's a very slow progressive and indolent most of the ILDs. So on chest X-ray you will find a reticular pattern, a nodicular-reticular pattern, mostly subpleurally you will find. Then is something called honeycombing, which will be more appreciated on the CT scan. But standard X-ray might appear normal in 10% of the cases, and where then the high resolution CT is the modality of choice, the diagnostic modality of choice. And there are certain radiological features, and on chest X-ray, where if you have a predominant involvement of the mid and upper lung zones, we might find sarcoidosis or pulmonary laryngeal histiocytosis, silicosis, hypersensitive pneumonitis. If there is more like a pleural based reticular infiltrates, you can safely suspect idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis such patient. Then you have associated with the lymphadenopathy, which is more common in sarcoidosis. It's present mostly initial stage. It tends to have a lymphadenopathy. Then further it encompasses the lung parenchyma. Then if there is a lymphagic spread of the lung cancer, or if there is berylosis, amyloidosis, they can present as enterothoracic lymphadenopathy. Then spontaneous pneumothorax can be associated with cystic ILDs like in lymphangioleiomyomatosis and pulmonary laryngeal histiocytosis. Fiber optic bronchoscopy is another one of the very important diagnostic modality, but usually clinically, practically, it should be accompanied after an HRCT. HRCT should be the diagnostic modality of choice, because HRCT also helps you to understand the actual through the bronchoscopy, the actual lavage, the segment of the lungs where you can confidently take the lavage for the diagnosis purpose. So like the standard fiber optic bronchoscopy, the bronchoalveolar lavage is useful for confirming several alveolar hemorrhage syndromes, eosinophilic pneumonia, then pulmonary infection. The modality of choice is basically transbronchial lung biopsy or transbronchial lung through bronchoscopy, where you take several specimen, and that can be aided by a proper HRCT, and that in a way it tells about, like in sarcoidosis you will have altered CD4 CD8 count on the lavage specimen, or certain cases you might have a decrease in CD4 CD8 ratio. So fiber optic bronchoscopy and alveolar lavage is one of the very important tool for diagnosis. And then the surgical lung biopsy, definitely it is a procedure of choice in establishing a diagnosis, definitive diagnostic modality in cases of idiopathic pulmonary pneumonia. But and the other thing is, the surgical lung biopsy can be guided by distribution of disease on HRCT. So the HRCT should be a compulsory, should be a compulsion, and should be a necessity in cases of ILD, which is further can be accompanied by the subsequent test which you will order depending on the symptoms and the management of the patient. Then there is something called video assisted thoracoscopic surgery. Since it has a less morbidity than open thoracotomy, so this is a very, very definitely a very novel and a precise and a convenient technique for biopsy collection. And there is so this is a basically a small algorithm where patient present to you with dry cough, breathlessness, which is bilateral, then you have a chest radiograph where you find a bilateral reticular pattern or a nodular or even a mottling or mosaic pattern or a ground glass pattern. Then your PFT, you find a restrictory pattern, you order a HRCT. In HRCT again you find a mild patchy involvement or a mid-distal lymphadenopathy, or without lymphadenopathy you find an extensive lung involvement, which more denotes or it's more indicative of idiopathic IAP. And then or if it's accompanied by a patchy involvement with mid-distal lymphadenopathy, you can even order a ACE, acetyl converting enzyme, that ACE test you can order for sarcoidosis, or certain other connective tissue, can think of other antibody tests. those blood tests, and then you can order a transbronchial or surgical lung biopsy to establish a diagnosis. And but if HRCT is more pertaining to something like IIP, then you can start with the treatment trial, and if it doesn't respond, you can try for a lung biopsy, or you can then order a palliative treatment. So our objective of management, the ILD cases, when it comes to your clinic, it will be a very indolent and progressive. When they come, they might be in a very bad state of mind and a bad state, bad condition. Our main management is to give them a symptomatic relief, and they improve their quality of life, and even try to slow down the disease progression, if not in totality, try to prevent collection, then try to prolong survival, and try to prevent treatment complications. And if it's a very patient with a grave prognosis, with patients with a late stage of fibrosis or interstitial fibrosis, then you can give them a palliative treatment. So main treatment modality is the drugs which are used. They fall under anti-inflammatory drugs like corticosteroid, and most of these ILDs they respond to corticosteroid in a particular dosage, and can follow a particular regimen. And if it doesn't help, then you can add on azathioprine or cyclophosphamide, and then continue corticosteroid in a lower dose, or you can try certain antifibrotic agents like thalidomide, and pirfenidone is one of the newer drugs, pentoxifilin, tissue growth factor beta antagonist, or interferon gamma. These are the antifibrotic drugs which can be tried. Then there's something for antioxidant agents, nitric oxide synthase inhibitor or N-acetylcysteine. These are more of a palliative treatment, and supportive as the patient's conditions demand. You can go for the oxygen therapy or pulmonary vasodilator or diuretics, or even antibiotics when there is a concomitant infection. So this is all about ILD. In the next class, I'll touch certain ILDs, certain types of ILDs, and in a short description of certain types of ILDs, and I will also try to recap about the ILDs. And this is one difficult topic to understand and memorize, but the best part of ILD is the management is not that complex. So any question, you can fire in your messages. Anything you want to know about? It's a very complex topic, and it's a topic to be undertaken in pathology as well as medicine. So you have to be very patient with the topic, and you should no need to know in and out. But you should always be, you should be verse or average of the normal nomenclature or the types. I think it must have been a very nerve-wracking session for you, because you don't have much of the queries. I understand that. The next class we'll recap, and we'll try to take up individual ILDs, and we'll give a brief description and try to get away with this topic. So I can't see any query. Thank you so much, class. So we'll meet the coming Saturday in continuation with the class on ILDs. Thank you for your patient listening, class.